The dream of many young men is to someday play college baseball, to represent their school and its community through our country's greatest game. The talented and the hardworking may achieve that dream. The elite reach for a higher goal, Omaha, Nebraska, and the College World Series. In 1993, Coach Mark Johnson and his Aggies were among the elite. The Aggie Express to Omaha took a few unexpected detours. Starting shortstop Paul Barber was injured in a car accident and would be lost for the season. His replacement, sophomore Rob Harris, had made the switch from second base to shortstop, but was hit by a pitch in the season opening game against Dallas Baptist and would be out for 2 weeks. Not an encouraging beginning to the season. Many teams might not respond well to such adversity, but this 1993 Aggie squad had a special spark and was determined to stay on track. I'm ready for more. The season was underway and the magic was back at the shack by the track as the Washington Huskies came to Olsen Field for a four-game series. The Aggies swept the series with the Pac-10 power, three of them in come-from-behind fashion. The Aggies fueled their competitive fires with a bit of raw power as home runs by Brian Thomas, John Curl, and David Miner highlighted the weekend. Texas A&M cruised through the next week en route to a perfect 11-0 record to start the season. Those loyal Aggie fans had again caught Aggie baseball fever. The University of Pan American were next to fall as sophomore left-hander Trey Moore saddled the Bronx with a 4-1 loss, followed by two more late-inning victories to extend A&M's season record to 14-0. The winning streak was halted at the hands of Southwest Texas State 1-0 in the first game of a doubleheader. But with Rob Harris back in the lineup, the Aggies avenged the loss with a victory over the Bobcats, sparked by Harris's two-run homer. The University of Maine came in from the cold for a visit to Olsen Field. The Black Bears held a one-run lead going into the final inning. Harlan's liner to center field was snared for the final out, robbing A&M of yet another possible come-from-behind win. As they had already proven, the 1993 Aggies had very little patience for losing, and the Black Bears were blistered 11-2 in the second game of that doubleheader. Just for good measure, the Aggs posted a patented late-inning victory in the third game of the series, their ninth such thriller of the young season. Spring break took the Aggie Express on the road for sweeps of New Orleans and southeastern Louisiana. Texas A&M's 23-2 record was the best in college baseball, but a new season was about to begin. Southwest Conference play. As one of the most competitive conferences in the country, the 1993 Southwest Conference race was predicted to be one of the toughest in history. All seven teams were ranked in the nation's top 20, with Texas A&M holding down the number four spot. In the conference opening series against TCU, left-handers Jeff Granger and Trey Moore put together back-to-back complete game victories before dropping the third game to the Horned Frogs 3-2. The Aggies were back on the road the following week against the University of Houston. Game two seemed to resemble a classic Aggie-Cougar football matchup as A&M came away with a 20-10 win. The Aggies staged another version of its run and shoot in the final game with a 19-14 11th inning win that actually took 2 days to complete due to darkness. NAIA power Mary Harden Baylor rolled in for a midweek series to try and knock the Aggies off the track. They almost did. Trailing by 5 runs in their last at-bat, A&M once again came back with a vengeance, scoring 6 runs as the first 6 batters reached base, claiming an 8-7 victory. Lubbock Christian made an appearance at Olsen Field later that same week, but no late-inning heroics were necessary this time. Jeff Granger set a school and Southwest Conference record with 21 strikeouts and tossing a 2-hit shutout. The historic evening is not one Granger will ever forget.
That's something I'll carry around for the rest of my life and no one can take away.
After playing their first 6 conference games on the road, the Aggs hosted conference-leading Texas Tech, and the fans were out in force to greet the Red Raiders. Granger was outstanding again as the Aggies claimed a 9-1 victory, giving Mark Johnson his 400th career victory, all of which at A&M. Trey Moore picked up his 9th win of the season without a loss and aided himself offensively with 3 hits in Game 2. Aggie pitching continued to dominate. This time, Kelly Wunsch punched out a career-high 14 batters in 7 innings of work. Brian Parker closed out the game with a save, giving the Aggies a clean sweep. The next hurdle for the Aggies were the Baylor Bears in a 3-game set that began with a single game in Waco. With Trey Moore pitching shutout ball for A&M, the game was a scoreless tie going into the 10th inning. With runners on first and second, third baseman Lee Fedora hit a grounder to the first baseman that had the making of a double play ball. The toss from shortstop was wild, and the Aggies scored the go-ahead run. Moore, who had led off the rally with a single, retired the Bears in the bottom of the 10th to earn his 10th win of the season. A record Parents Weekend crowd greeted the two teams at Olsen Field the next day. Another low-scoring contest unfolded in the first game of the twin bill as Baylor claimed a 2-1 win. The Aggies fell behind in the second game of the doubleheader, but a 6-run rally in the 5th inning brought the home team back. An outstanding pitching performance by Kelly Wunsch guided A&M to the victory, number 40 for the season, and improved the Aggies' conference mark to 10-2. Southwest Conference race, as expected, was tightening up. Fans of all ages were enjoying the ride, sharing the Aggies' successful season. During a break in their routine, the Aggies welcomed a special visitor to a practice, President George Bush, former Commander-in-Chief and Yale first baseman. On campus to review plans for the George Bush Presidential Library, he spoke to the Aggies on his own experience in playing at the College World Series.
He hit a ball that's still rolling and telling him to do Michigan. And then we won it the next year. We won and played against Southern Cal.
The Aggies wanted nothing better than to experience Omaha firsthand. But before that could occur, there was still the task of closing out the Southwest Conference race. The Rice Owls arrived in College Station looking to set back the league-leading Aggies, but A&M clipped the Owls 7-6, sparked by a pair of home runs by Brian Thomas and a 2-run blast by John Curl. A seesaw battle in Game 2 kept the crowd anxious as Rice jumped out to an early 6-2 lead. In the 3rd inning, catcher Robert Lewis belted a towering grand slam to tie the game. Stephen Claybrook joined the power parade with his 2nd career home run that gave the Aggies the lead for good. Lewis was the hitting star in the 3rd game of the series with 4 hits, including another home run to help A&M complete the sweep over Rice. Excellent defense and pitching kept the Roadrunners of UTSA from scoring as A&M continued their winning ways, headed into the matchup of the year. Jeff Granger dreamed of it. Sports Illustrated wrote about it, and Aggie fans retreated to it. The Southwest Conference game between two of the top teams in the country at Olsen Field. Number 3 Texas versus number 1 Texas A&M. At stake, the conference title and bragging rights throughout the state. In order for the Longhorns to share the crown, they would have to sweep the top-ranked Aggies. In the tradition of Aggie loyalty, fans camped out overnight to get tickets to the series opener, when A&M would have the chance to clinch the title outright for the first time since 1964. More than 9,000 fans squeezed into the Olsen Field complex to see two future first-rounders square off, Jeff Granger versus Texas ace Brooks Kieschnick. The Aggie defense set the pace early in the game, retiring the Longhorns in order. Robert Harris ignited the early Aggie charge with a first-inning double. He went to third on a Longhorn error, then scored the game's first run on a sacrifice fly by Trey Moore. The spotlight was focused on the pitcher's mound this night, and Granger was making the most of it, blistering his 92-mile-per-hour fastball past UT batters. Kieschnick provided the Aggies with an opportunity in the fifth inning when his throwing error on Stephen Claybrook's bunt set up an RBI single by Brian Thomas, giving A&M a 2-0 lead. In the seventh inning, the Aggies scored four more runs, highlighted by Harris's three-run home run, chasing Kieschnick from the mound. As the contest moved into the ninth inning, the Aggie fans could sense a Southwest Conference title coming their way. In typical A&M UT fashion, the game ain't over until the fight songs are sung. And sometimes, not even then. In the top of the ninth, with A&M on top, 6-0, the Longhorns pushed across two runs. But Granger wouldn't let down. And with two outs, Texas' Mark Prather grounded out to Robert Harris, ending the UT rally and solidifying A&M's sole possession of the conference crown. However, the team celebration was put on hold as the Aggs traveled to Austin the next day to complete the split series. To punctuate their title-clinching victory the evening before in College Station, the Aggies posted a 9-1 shellacking over the Longhorns at Dishfalk Field. Trey Moore was masterful on the hill, collecting his 11th victory of the season.
I've been an Aggie all my life, and, you know, when you grow up, you know, wanting to beat Texas, and for me to do it individually, you know, and have that, you know, in the record books as me getting the win, that was really big.
Texas A&M finished the regular season with a 47-7 record, a 15-3 conference mark, and a number one ranking in both the Collegiate Baseball and Baseball America polls. And the finest jewel of all to this point, the Southwest Conference Championship. The Aggies traveled to Austin following a 10-day layoff for the Southwest Conference postseason tournament. Following an opening round loss to Texas, A&M engaged in a seesaw battle with Texas Tech before finally putting the Red Raiders away with a 10-8 win. In another emotion-filled contest, the Aggies and Longhorns locked up in an elimination round game. The lead changed hands seven times before Lee Fedora's two-out, ninth-inning home run tied the game at 10. Texas pushed across the winning run in the bottom of the inning to claim the victory and stay alive in the tournament, which was eventually won by the Baylor Bears. By virtue of its record in regular season conference championship, Texas A&M was granted an at-large berth in the NCAA playoffs. Through the hard work and preparation of the athletic department, the Aggies were awarded the opportunity to again host the Central Regional Tournament at Olsen Field. It was an outstanding lineup, with North Carolina, UCLA, Lamar, Hawaii, and Yale visiting Aggieland to compete for a spot in the College World Series. The Aggie fans have displayed their loyalty throughout the season, but never was it more evident than on opening night of the Central Regional Tournament. Texas A&M's first round game with Ivy League champion Yale was delayed for more than 2 hours by rain. Yet a sold-out crowd of 5,312 remained at Olsen Field until past 2 o'clock in the morning as the Aggies put together a 16-hit performance en route to a 13-1 win. Their bats remained hot the next day with a 17-hit, 10-5 victory over Lamar. Next up was UCLA, with the winner advancing to the championship game. The Bruins threatened early, but Kelly Wunsch began a rally-ending double play that set the Aggies on course. Timely hitting led to an early A&M lead. UCLA kept the game close, and after pitching a sensational game, Chris Clemens came out of the pen to take over. Again, a rally-ending double play kept A&M in command. In the eighth inning, with the bases loaded, Lee Fedora stepped up to the plate, and he put the game away with a grand slam over the right field wall. The Aggies were one win away from a trip to the College World Series, a position that in recent years was all too familiar. Their opponent, the North Carolina Tar Heels, the top two seeds looking to harvest a Midwestern dream, Omaha. For the final time in 1993, the Aggies took the field before the Olsen Field crowd, which again was standing room only. And they remained standing as A&M pushed across three runs to take an early lead. It was yet another benchmark day for Jeff Granger and senior co-captains Brian Thomas and Billy Harlan. Thomas etched his name into the A&M record book with a ninth-inning triple, setting a school single season and career mark for three baggers, as if inspired by all the Aggie baseball teams in recent years who had come so close to earning a trip to Omaha. The 93 squad turned this regional championship game into a party, and everyone was invited. In the seventh inning, Granger left the game to a standing ovation, the final time this two-sport phenom would play in front of the home crowd. A&M's latest power source, Lee Fedora, blasted a three-run homer in the sixth inning to put the Aggies in front 13-1, and the crowd was beginning the countdown.
A&M is amazing. They're leading not only the conference, but the world in hitting, stealing, pitching. Most complete team we've seen in a long time.
After leading off the inning with a pop flyout, John Codrington retired the second Tar Heel hitter with a strikeout.
Only one out remaining. You can feel the excitement here at Olsen. Codrington on the mound. Here's the pitch. Ground ball to second base. Martin over in front of it. He's going to make the play to first. The Aggies win it. The Aggies win it.
And the Aggies had won the Central One regional title. This team was on fire and headed to Omaha.
Take a little trip. Take a little trip. Take a little trip up to heaven.
The 1993 College World Series was, as always, an excellent field of teams, perhaps the finest ever. And the Aggies were given the number one seed by the NCAA selection committee. They were set to go, facing the Kansas Jayhawks in round one, before the largest opening day crowd in College World Series history. But the misfortune that greeted the Aggies to begin the season repeated just minutes prior to the game, as Lee Fedora was struck in the mouth during batting practice, taking him and his sizzling bat out of the Aggie lineup. Having experienced and overcome similar adversity earlier in the season, the Aggies pulled together again. John Curl's RBI single in the first inning gave A&M the early lead. Third baseman Robert Lewis, inserted at the position following the injury to Fedora, began an outstanding double play to kill an early Kansas scoring threat. With the game knotted at one, Brian Thomas broke the deadlock with a solo blast over the center field wall. A&M pushed across three more runs in the eighth inning on singles by Harris, Lewis, and Trimble. Chris Clemens relieved Granger and held off Kansas through the ninth inning. The Aggies had notched their first win in Omaha. The next obstacle, old nemesis LSU. Again, the Aggies took the early lead with two runs in the third inning, but LSU tied the game with a pair in its half of the inning. An explosive fifth inning for A&M produced five runs, knocking LSU's All-American pitcher Brett Laxton from the game. But the Tigers' offense kept pace, scoring four runs to keep the game close. The two teams exchanged runs until the eighth inning, when LSU put the game out of reach, handing the Aggies their first loss. In the elimination game, Texas A&M faced Long Beach State. Robert Harris tied the game at one with one swing of the bat in the third inning. Long Beach State took the lead and, despite repeated challenges by the Aggies, held off the top seed time after time. As the opportunities passed by, so did the innings, until at last there were no opportunities left. Perhaps the Aggies had spent their allotment of miracles, because just as the evening shadows began their descent over Rosenblatt Stadium, the curtain came down on a remarkable season for Texas A&M. The 1993 Texas A&M baseball team solidified its reputation as a national powerhouse, finishing the season with a 53-11 record, the best in college baseball for the season, the second best in school history, and a number two final season ranking. The Aggies' 93 ledger was an impressive reading, an outright Southwest Conference championship, the NCAA regional championship, a number one ranking for six consecutive weeks, the longest in the nation. And for the first time in over 20 years, the trip to Omaha and the College World Series. The 1993 Aggies proved once and for all that the road to Omaha can indeed pass through College Station, where the team to beat is not only on the field, but also in the stands and throughout the community.
Olsen Field. You know, every other team that comes in there has to play against a tough team, plus a tough stadium of, you know, great fans that support you all the way through the year.
The fans here are incredible, and I can say just for this season, they're a big part of our season this year.
The way people back baseball here. You know, I would hate to come play against A&M here at AHU. You know, the fans really get behind you, and they make you feel good. They make you feel real good.
When you're down and troubled and you need a helping hand, nothing, well, nothing is going right. Close your eyes and think of me, and soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just call out my name, and you know wherever I am, I'll come running, oh yeah, baby, to see you again. Winter, spring, summer, or fall, got to do is call, and I'll be there, yeah, yeah, yeah. You've got a friend. If the sky above you should turn dark and full of clouds, and that old north wind should begin to blow, keep your head together and call my name out loud now. Soon I'll be knocking upon your door. Just call.